Thank you. the good news of Jesus, according to John.
Glory to you, O Christ.
Jesus said, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, because he abides with you, and he will be in you. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. They who have my commandments and keep them are those who love me. And those who love me will be loved by my Father, and I will love them and reveal myself to them." The Gospel of the Savior.
Praise to you, O Christ.
In the name of God, whose love is unconditional.
Amen.
At face value, today's gospel sounds manipulatively familiar. If you loved me, you would fill in the blank. Simon and I play that game. If you loved me, you'd get me apple juice and swords. This kind of transactional love feels uncomfortable in the Bible. It puts us on the spot to get it right or disappoint God. It feels too much like the way religion has manipulated culture wars and holiness codes to suit their personal agendas. They have defined commandments in ways unintended by this passage and by the community of John. They peddle fear rather than love to control and create a religious world in their own image. A young woman was coerced by her parents into marrying an older man. He was stern and verbally abusive. She felt no love, but understood that it was her duty to obey her husband. The matters of obedience were carefully defined. He wrote out what he expected day by day, in addition to cooking and any chores that he might add along the way. She learned to keep her head down, never argue, and make sure that her cleaning, washing, ironing, gardening, and other duties were done to his exacting standards. She experienced no love or affirmation, simply criticism and maybe a slap across the face if he was upset. Several years into the marriage, the man had a massive heart attack and died. She felt guilty that she only experienced relief. In the ensuing years, she made a life for herself. But almost two decades later, she fell in love with a man that she met in church. They married, and she marveled each day how different marriage was to a man who loved her. One day, while rummaging in the attic, looking for an old recipe book, she found the sheet of paper her first husband had given her with the rules and tasks that were demanded of her. As she read through the list, she began to laugh. These were the same things she did now. The only difference was the joy of doing it from a place of love. This is an example of what Jesus was asking of his disciples, to participate in the circular nature of love. It gives and receives. Jesus specifically used the word love 13 times in his teaching, but showed what love was by his life. His forgiveness, kindness, patience, gentleness, mercy, encouragement, fellowship, healing, and sacrifice. In this passage from John's farewell discourse, Jesus was preparing his disciples for his earthly departure. He wanted them to understand what it would mean to follow in his footsteps. Jesus was challenging them to explore the depths of non-transactional love. In the previous chapter to today's gospel, Jesus said, "I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you should also love. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." He reiterated this in the chapter following the one that we read today. "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, that a man lay down his life for one's friends." We see in this passage the overwhelming, repetitive, circular emphasis on love. He had shown his disciples how to be in the world by the example of his life. He assured them that the Spirit of the Holy would be their constant companion. He promised that if they chose to live in this way of living, they would experience the fullness of God's love and life in God. So, we see that Jesus isn't making a conditional statement about love and behavior, but instead is putting forth an obvious fact that when you love someone, really, really love someone, doing what is good and right comes so much more naturally and easily. Parents can be a good illustration of this. It may be a challenge at times to be a parent, but the love one feels for one's children makes it a no-brainer to do what's good for them, even when it's not easy. It's obvious that if you love your children, you're going to respond with sacrificial love and all that it entails. Maybe this is why the prophets and the Gospels refer to God as a mother hen, the one that will gather her chicks under her wings to protect them from danger. Mothering is a role of love and nurture, not gender or maternity. "My childless aunt lived with us all my growing up years, and she mothered me as much as my biological mother did. I was mothered by a high school teacher, an English teacher, who saw below the surface of my depressed exterior. My husband and I mothered our daughter that we were privileged to raise together." Mothering is a way of being. At its purest, it is a human example of God's way of being built right into the world. Right now, our world could use more mothering. Mothering loves all the children and rejoices in their uniqueness. Mothering invites kids to play well with their neighbors. Mothering encourages egalitarian sharing of their toys. Mothering teaches respect for boundaries. Mothering encourages authenticity. Mothering comforts the hurt, cares for the sick, provides for the daily needs, fiercely protects, and all the while loves each one despite their behaviors. This sounds to me like what Jesus is asking of each of us as we live our lives in this world. Jesus is saying, if you love me, your life will reflect God's mothering love. I'm going to ask that anyone who's mothered an aging relative in their final years to please stand as you're able. If you've mothered a child that was not your own, please join those that are standing. If you're a teacher and have mothered a classroom of children, please stand. If you are a teacher, If you have mothered a neighbor who was sick, please stand. If you've mothered a person that was incarcerated, please stand. If you've mothered a person struggling with mental illness, please stand. If you've mothered at Sunday supper, please stand. This is men and women. If you've mothered at showers, please stand. If you've mothered an immigrant, please stand. If you are a mother, please stand. If you've experienced a mothering love, please stand. See, you've already experienced what God tells us to do for the whole world. This is the love of God that Jesus asks of us to show the entire world. Happy Mother's Day. Amen.